Let's look to Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning with verse 20 this morning. Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning with verse 20. We talked last week about moving on in, moving into some things. And I really believe that the Lord set us up here into a new season at Grace Fellowship Church. While we are moving into a new property and a new season, just in the natural sense of being in a new place here in town, I believe that the Lord also is saying to us that in 2017, we are moving into something deeper and we're moving into something greater. With the Lord, there is always more. Amen. And you should never get stuck in this thing of believing that this is all there is. God wants to increase you more and more and more. And last week we talked about this, how that God brought the children of Israel out for one purpose, that he might bring them in. And I believe he has brought us out again and again in our lives individually so that he might bring us in. You have to understand, when the Lord brings you out of a season, it's only so that he might bring you into something else. And when the Lord does this thing called transition in our life, it is always for our good. Now, how many believes the Lord is working for your good? If you don't believe that, we got to settle that. Now, I think we settled it last week, but you've got to get it settled in your life that God is not a bad God. He's not up there trying to get to you or trying to destroy you. He is doing everything that he can to bless you and to bring you into his perfect plan. And his plan is a good plan. It's always the best plan. Some folks think that we are sacrificing our lives by coming and gathering together in church on Sunday. They think, well, how can you give up every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, Wednesday night, to come and sit through a service? I just want to say to you today, I don't feel like I have given anything up in serving the Lord. I have gained everything. Amen. So the world has a different view here, and that is to serve God is less. But I've got news for you, to serve him is more. Amen. And the more you serve him, the more there is. And so we're going to continue on this line this morning, but let's go back and read our text. Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning with verse 20. When your son asks you in the time to come, saying, what is the meaning of the testimonies, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord our God has commanded you? Then you shall say to your son, we were slaves. We were slaves. Notice we're not, we were. We were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed signs and wonders before our eyes, great and severe, against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household. Then he brought us out from there that he might bring us in. Let's say that together. Say, he brought us out from there that he might bring us in. And then it goes on and say, to give us the land which he swore to our fathers, and the Lord commanded us to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is this day. Then it will be righteousness for us if we are careful to observe all these commandments before the Lord our God as he has commanded us. Notice again, verse 23, they said he brought us out that he might bring us in. But then there's another statement, to give us the land. Last week we talked about there are times he brings you out of something so that he can bring you in. And when the Lord is working on bringing you out, don't fight against him. Amen. Don't fight against the Lord when he's trying to get you out of something. Amen. Because it's always for your good. And sometimes people say, well, you know, the Lord's trying to get me out of this season, or the Lord's trying to get me out of this relationship, or the Lord wants me to break some ties over here, or leave some things behind over there. Any time and every time the Lord is saying, get thee out, it always means he has something more on the other side. And we talked about some examples last week. The Lord said to Abram, get thee out from among your kindred and your homeland. And then he goes on and says, that I may bless you. And so Abram was blessed. We talked about different ones in Scripture last week that the Lord brought out of certain places always to bring them in. And when the Lord says, move on in, he is saying, it's going to be more blessed. It's going to be greater. You're going to have greater peace. You're going to have greater joy. You're going to have greater everything when you follow the Lord to move on in to what God has for you. Everybody shout, I'm moving on in. Amen. Well, we can't dwell there too long. But notice he said, I've not just brought you out to bring you in. That verse 23 said to give us the land. Everybody said to give us the land. In other words, the Lord said, I'm going to give you something. When the Lord seems to be taking something, it is always to give you something. And when it seems the Lord is taking something away or asking you to sacrifice something or asking you to give up something, I can assure you that it is always so that he might give unto you. How many of you know our God is a giving God? In fact, the Bible says, you ought to know this verse by heart, that the Lord so loved this world, God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever might believe in him would not perish, should not perish, but would have everlasting life. The Lord gave his son so that we might have everlasting life. He gave his son on the cross so that he might give us everlasting life. When the Lord gives something, he may require us to give up something, but it's always for our good. Can you shout amen? Now, they were to move in to this land called, we call it two things in Scripture. We call it the Promised Land, and sometimes we refer to it as Canaan Land. It doesn't matter too much because any way you study it in Scripture, the end result is good. A couple of verses here. Let me just read to you. For instance, Exodus 6, beginning with verse 6, the Bible said, therefore say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burdens of Egypt. I will rescue you from their bondage. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. I will take you as my people and I will be your God. Then listen what he said. He said, then you shall know that I am the Lord your God who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will bring you into the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a heritage. I am the Lord. Now again, here the Lord's talking about bringing you out. The Lord's talking about redeeming you. Have you been redeemed? How many feel like you've been brought out? He said, but I've done all of that so that I may bring you into the land that I swore to Abraham. God is saying, I'm doing all this for one reason. And that reason is that I can bring you into a place that I have prepared for you. Now, we in the church know the scripture in John chapter 14 where the Bible talks about, you know, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And we think of that as the place of mansions and the place where the streets are made of gold and the place where the gates are pearl and the place where we are going to live forever with the Lord Jesus. And that is a reality. But can I say to you that Jesus prepared more than a physical place called heaven for you and I to dwell in when he went away to prepare a place for us? I'm in a new kingdom. I'm not in the same world. I may be living in the world, but I'm not of this world. I am in a new kingdom, translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His dear Son. I've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. I am no longer the same. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. I am a new creation in Christ. And yes, He has prepared a mansion in glory for me, a place when I die. But I want to tell you, He also died to prepare a new place of authority and a new place of blessing for me, so that my life on earth is not the same as it was before I got saved. How many found out your life is not the same anymore? And I guess I need to drill this home. It's not supposed to be. I mean, in my church, all we ever sang was the songs about heaven. And thank God for heaven. But my life is more blessed here. Thank God for the sweet by and by, but I'm so glad there's some good now and now. Hallelujah. But a lot of folks have never heard this and never considered this, and it's not preached, and they don't read their Bible about this. I am here to announce to you that whatever happened to those Old Testament saints was an example to you and I. When the Lord redeemed them, He brought them out of bondage to take them into something, a promised land of blessing. He has also brought us out of sin and prepared a place for us in eternity, but my life has been moved from one kingdom to the next so that I can walk in the blessing and the goodness of the Lord right here in the earth realm. I've got a helper that I didn't used to have. I got a friend I didn't used to have. I got one walking in me that I did not used to have, and He's making all the difference. Has He made a difference in your life? All right, let's go a step further. Deuteronomy 6, verse 3. Therefore, hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you and that you may multiply greatly, as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. Everybody shout, milk and honey. Seems like that is the typical description of the promised land. There's a lot of other verses that describe it, but if you really summed it up over and over and over again in Scripture, it is known as the land which flows with milk and honey. Is that right? We wrote songs about it. That terminology is describing a place, and I'm going to give you what different writers, how they describe what milk and honey means, because if all you've got in your mind is a gallon of milk and a bottle of honey, you've got the wrong picture. I like milk somewhat. I love honey. Good honey. But it means a land or a place where luxuries are plentiful and easily acquired. It means a land that is fertile. How many of you know all land is not fertile? Some you're going to have a hard time raising anything in, but if you get the right soil and the right conditions, oh, it will produce, won't it? This land that flows with milk and honey, this Canaan land, promised land, is a place that is fertile. It also means superior in quality. There was a rabbi who had wrote about this, and he said it symbolizes the richness of taste and the nourishment of what that land would produce. Now, let's put this in a literal sense for just a moment. I have been to Israel, and I've been to Egypt. You can't go to Egypt now as easily. It's dangerous. I wouldn't go on the trip that I went at that time for nothing unless the Lord spoke to me about going. But I traveled through the deserts of Egypt, And they're just exactly that,
desert.
And every now and then out there, you will run into a place that there is a spring of water, and when you got water, things will end up being green. But for the most part, we traveled for days and in this journey that the children of Israel took across the Red Sea, right on up to Sinai, and it is nothing more or less than desert. But when we got to Israel, if you've ever been to Israel, it is amazing. When we got to Israel, there was hillsides of vineyards and hillsides of green, lush trees and different things. The olive trees were amazing. And I thought, wow, it's just like the Bible says. I mean, you leave Egypt and you move into Israel, and there is an immediate noticeable difference. God said, this is the land I'm going to give my people. It is going to be a place that will produce, a place that is fertile, good soil, a place of good harvest, a place, I mean, just across the border, you can't raise anything. But in God's given land, you will be able to produce, you will see success, you will be able to see things flourishing, and it's going to be good, and it's going to be prosperous. I want to tell you, there's a spiritual connection as well. When you move out of the land of the enemy, and when you leave sin's life behind and you join up with the army of the Lord, there is something that ought to occur in your life called the blessing. Everybody shout the blessing, because we're going to talk about that in this message today. Really, what the Lord was saying to the children of Israel is, I want to bring you to the place of blessing. The place of blessing. You've been in Egypt, you've been in bondage, you've been a slave, you've been bound, you've been mastered over by the taskmasters of Egypt. You lived in houses you didn't own, you lived on land you didn't have, that wasn't really yours. You did what everybody else said. You're under the rule of the king of Egypt, but I am here to tell you, I'm bringing you to a place of blessing. And if you really want to sum up what the land that flows with milk and honey is, literally, it is a land of blessing. But if you want to sum up what it is spiritually, it is also a land of blessing. God is not trying to take anything from you. God is trying to get more to you. God is not trying to rob you. God is not a thief. He is not a robber. God is not a taker. God is always a giver. God is doing everything in His power with all that He has to offer to bless you more than you've ever been blessed in your life. Some of you are going to have to sit there and ponder that a little bit, because religion has told you, well, we don't get blessed down here. All of our blessings are spiritual and in heavenly places. Yeah, but I want to tell you, there's some blessings that will come in this earth realm, and you might not need them, but I need the blessing of the Lord right now in this day that I'm living in until I leave this world. All right, let's get this. Turn around and tell somebody, I said, we're going to get this. The promised land is a place of blessing. Now, in the creation, see, sometimes you got to go back all the way to the beginning of the book. But in Genesis chapter 1, God created. You learned about it in Sunday school. He created all kinds of things. If you go through the creation, it's interesting. It begins to name one thing right after another that God did in the creation. But there's something that stands out to me over and over again when God starts looking at His creation. For instance, the Bible said in Genesis chapter 1, God caused the dry land to separate from the waters. He looked and He saw that it was good. Everybody say good. We're going to see a pattern here. Then you go a little further. It says that God brought forth grass and herbs that yield seed. And then it says it again. God looked and He saw. It was good. And then you go a little further. It says God divided the light from the darkness, and he saw that it was. Come on, you can preach a little better than that. And then he created sea creatures and birds, and God saw that it was. And then he created the beast of the earth. He created cattle and so on. And he looked and he saw that it was. Are you seeing a pattern here? And verse 31 said, then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Do you see a pattern that what God was creating was good? And then he created man, and that was good too. Then he gave man a whoa man, and he said, whoa man, that is really good. But it was all good. Everybody shout, it's all good. God didn't create anything bad, nothing tragic. He looked at everything he was doing, and it was good. Somebody said, how could it all be good? Because it was coming out of a good God. Hallelujah. And all that flows out of him is good. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father above. There is no shadow nor turning in him. In other words, there's not a sign of darkness in him. There's not a hint of evil in him. He's not good one day and bad the next. He's not mostly good and a little bit bad. No, God is 100% good, and his creation was good. And he looked at everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And Adam and Eve were created, and the next thing we know, sin entered the picture. And then you have bad. You have evil. You have everything associated with bad. And let me say it like this, a bad life. Now it exists. Anything. Was no poverty in that garden. Until sin. Was no sickness. Wasn't any in that garden until sin. There's no murder going on. But guess what? When sin entered the picture, what happens in the next, just a few pages over in your Bible, Cain murders Abel. Sin. Then you go on a little further, and Noah, in the days of Noah, the Bible said that every man's heart and imagination of his heart was on evil things continually. Are y'all listening this morning? Look up here and say, I'm listening, Pastor. The reason I need you to understand this is when it started with God, it was good. And when God looked at it, it was very good. And everything else that we see today that is not good, it has to do with the fact that man failed and sin, and all of a sudden entrance is given to everything that you and I see in this world. And not only has sin been there the whole time from the fall, it has increased more and more and more. And Jesus even said it like this, that in the last days, because iniquity or sin will abound, the love of many will wax cold. Sin is not at the same stage it was. Sin is on the increase, and it doesn't take a genius to figure that out. On the increase. But God is a good God and working for our good. I feel like I could get more shouting. I used to say we'd go down to Big Lots. Can't go to Big Lots anymore. Is the library open? The library is not open on Sunday. I said, God is a good God. Sin is rampant. The world has faced the curse, but God is a good God. And let me tell you how we see it displayed. I got to hurry, and we got to get where we're going here this morning. We see it displayed in the very fact that immediately, everybody say immediately, God goes to work to restore what has been lost. Now, he can't restore 100% everything with us living in this human body, but there is a day, glory to God, that all 100% will be restored when your born again spirit gets that new body that the Apostle Paul talked about to the Corinthian church. Hallelujah. This body sown in weakness, but it's going to be raised in power. There is a day. Everybody shout, there is a day. The Bible says that all of creation is groaning in expectation of this day that is coming when God is going to restore 100% everything and anything, and the devil will be cast into the pit forever. Hallelujah. And we're going to live with the Lord, and he shall be our God, and he shall wipe away all tears from our eyes, and we will live in his presence forevermore. All things are going to be made new. John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the former things have been passed away. I could just about preach. But God immediately started the process to bring good back to a fallen human race. And even with Noah, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And what happened as a result of Noah's grace? Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, Noah's wife, the boys' wives, were all spared in the great big boat called the Ark. That is the grace of God. While everybody else is dying, God's grace was sufficient and they were spared. But immediately after the Ark has landed, what happens? The sons of Noah get Noah into trouble, and the next thing you know, this thing's not working out. But then God comes to a man by the name of Abram and says, get out, Abram. I want you out from your father who is an idol worshiper. I want you out of what's been familiar, and I'm going to take you into something. Abraham said, I don't understand it, but I'm going to believe it and I'm going to receive it. God said, that's all I'm looking for, is somebody to believe and receive. And the Bible said, because Abraham believed God, it was counted unto him as righteousness. Hallelujah. And Abraham received a righteous standing with God, which nobody had gotten since Adam had failed in righteousness because of the fall of sin. Why was God so interested in all of this? So he could bless him. What's the next thing he said? I will bless thee. And not only am I going to bless thee, I'm going to make you a blessing. And I'm going to make your name great. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Turn around and tell somebody, say, don't get lost. Pastor's going somewhere. See, everything God is doing is to invoke blessing back to a creation that lost blessing. And he's doing it through covenant, and he's doing it through the blood of animals that are pointing toward the coming of a precious lamb by the name of Jesus who will be slain on Calvary. But it's all about bringing his people back to a place where he can again demonstrate himself. And the only way God knows how to demonstrate himself is through being good to us, because he knows nothing but being good. He can be nothing but good to those who love him, and his desire is to be good to the human race. Somebody said, I thought God was a bad God waiting to judge. The last thing God wants to do is judge anybody. It is not his will that any should perish, but that all would come into repentance. Why? So he might bless them and bring them in to this thing called the family of God. Have we got another minute? Everybody shout, bless. Everybody shout, bless three times. Y'all ready to get blessed? Turn around and tell somebody, say, this can be your year of blessing. Look at them again. Help me preach. Say, God can bless you right now. Now let's kick some religious cows. Turn around and tell somebody and tell them right now, say, it is God's will to bless you. Do you believe it?
Somebody said, I just don't know. Well, then don't be.
But I've looked, and I've studied it, and I'm studying it, and I'm studying to show myself approved, a workman that needeth not be ashamed. I am looking intently into this book from Genesis to Revelation, and I have found a picture of a good God who wants to be good to his people. The problem is we don't know it. Turn around and tell them again, say, God can bless you. Everybody shout bless. That Hebrew word bless means to endue with power. And don't let religious tradition kick you out of this right here and now. The word bless in the Hebrew, the original text, means to endue with power for success, fruitfulness, longevity, health, protection, and a whole lot more. That is the root word translated in your Bible to bless. That's the meaning of it. Prosperity, success, fruitfulness, longevity, health, and protection. And it's referred to in Scripture as the blessing. The blessing. The blessing. I remember when Pentecostals used to refer to the baptism in the Holy Ghost as the blessing. Well, it was a blessing. If you've never received the baptism in the Holy Spirit with the evidence speaking in other tongues, you have missed a blessing. And then sometimes they referred to it as the second blessing. I don't know. All I found out was it's all blessed. Glory to God. I'm glad he blessed me when he saved me. I'm glad he blessed me when he baptized me in the Holy Ghost. I'm glad he blessed me when he healed me. I'm glad he's blessed me when he's delivered me. I'm just glad he's blessing me. Why is he doing that? He's good. His desire is to spread goodness out. Moses said, show me your face. Show me, Lord. Let me see you. And Lord said, I'll hide you in the cleft of the rock. And he showed him his back parts. And what the Bible said, he caused his glory to pass by. And if you read further in that, it says the Lord caused his goodness to pass by. And Moses was so touched and moved by the goodness of the Lord, he came down and his face was shining, glowing with the goodness, I feel like preaching, with the goodness of the Lord, in so much the people said, put a veil over it. Sometimes when you preach things like this, people say, no, don't tell that. Put a veil over it. I didn't come put a veil over it. I came to tell you what the Word said. I came to tell you what the Holy Ghost has been saying. And the Holy Ghost has been trying to say to us, God is a good God, and he's ready to release goodness over your life. And this can be your year if you will hear it and believe for it. Bless, referring to the blessing. All right, two verses. Deuteronomy 28. And I want you to notice here the term, the Lord will command the blessing, not blessings, the blessing upon you and on your barns and in all that you put your hand to, and he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. Now notice here, he's going to declare the blessing on you. And then, as a result, he's also going to bless your barns and everything you put your hand to. He'll bless you. Where's he going to bless you? In the land where the Lord God gives you. It's important to be in the right place. That's another message. All right, now here's another place, and people, traditional people hate this verse, but it's just as much the Word of God as anything else in this book. And that is Proverbs 10, verse 22. The blessing. Now notice again, the blessing, not the blessings. The blessing of the Lord makes one rich and he adds no sorrow with it. One version says he makes one rich without laborsome toil. In other words, you're not going to have to work yourself to death. God's going to cause what you're putting your hands to prosper and to be fruitful and to be blessed. Doesn't that sound like the promised land or Canaan? Amen. And the writer in Proverbs said the blessing. Everybody say the blessing. Notice again, not the blessings. See, a lot of people are saying, oh, I want the blessings of the Lord. And we think about the blessings being if the Lord gives us a house to live in or a car to drive or clothes on our back and shoes on our feet and food to eat. These are all the blessings. But to get the blessings, you need the blessing. It might hit this house by tonight. To get the blessings, you can't have them without the blessing. The Lord said, I'm commanding the blessing. And then the blessings will follow. I'm going to bring this to the New Testament in a minute because somebody said this is old covenant teaching. Doesn't matter. Everything in the new is better than the old. We found out that whatever comes in Jesus will always be more than what came through the lambs and through the rams and through all the animals in the old. It's always more. Are you ready for the blessing? Because the blessing is not something that you get in things or in possessions. The blessings that are things, possessions, and all the other things, the healings and deliverances and whatever God does in your life. And let me just say to you today, they are too many for you to count. If you tried to make a list of all the blessings that God had bestowed upon you, you would have to go get another notebook and you would have to get another notebook because the blessings of the Lord are many. But they're a result of the blessing. Somebody said, are y'all shouting church? You stay around long enough, honey, and you'll find out. See, I'm a double shouter. I'm a shouting Baptist and a shouting Pentecostal. Pentecostals gave it this. Baptists gave it, woo! Hallelujah. I got a double dose. Woo! Woo! Glory! Woo! Hallelujah! And I'm not ashamed to shout. Somebody said, are you ashamed to shout? Do you think so? No, no, no. Woo! 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 Hallelujah! Glory to God. He's blessed me too much not to shout about it. Hallelujah! When I preached in the Baptist church, they used just to come to see me jump and shout till I started speaking in other tongues. That ended that. Everybody shout, blessed. God told Abraham, I will bless you. What he's saying is, I'm putting my blessing on you. And when the blessing came on Abraham, and the woman wasn't left out either, and Sarah. Lord have mercy, we need to not end this service. When the declared blessing came upon Abram and Sarah, whose names were changed to Abraham and Sarah, suddenly, I hope you got your shouting shoes on. Suddenly, that which was barren conceived. That which could bear nothing suddenly became fruitful. The only thing that changed was the declared blessing. And then the blessings started to flow. And guess what? A 90-year-old woman gets with child. And guess what else? 9 months later, there's a sound of the baby in the tent. Dear Lord, are you getting this? All because of the blessing, the blessings begin to flow. And the next thing you know, that which would not produce at 90 is producing. I've come to tell some of you the reason why you're trying to get some things to happen and it's not is because you've never embraced the blessing. Glory to God. You've never embraced the blessing. Somebody said, well, yes, I have. No, you've not. You got to embrace the blessing by faith. You got to believe that you're blessed going in, blessed going out. You are the head, not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You're blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. Everything you've owned is blessed. Your children are blessed. Your finances are blessed. You got to believe it. And too many in the church only see the blessing being in heaven. But I've come to tell you, God is good in heaven, but is also good in the earth. Hallelujah. And if you'll dare to believe him, he's going to release the blessing on you this year. Oh, somebody shout in this house. Shout, I claim the blessing. Shout, the blessing is mine. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. In my body. In my family. My bank account. I am blessed. Come on and give the Lord praise. I gotta close it, but we're moving in. I said we're moving in. We're moving in. Moving in. Jefferson's song was, I'm moving on up. Call it what you want, because when you move in, you move up. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The blessing lifts you up to a higher level. The blessing promotes you. The blessing changes your life. Jacob was a surplanter, a deceiver, but when the blessing got on him, even a deceiver. You know what that tells me? You may have lived a life of a deceiver, even like Rahab, the life of a harlot. But when the blessing gets on you, it doesn't matter, harlot, deceiver, whatever they called you, the blessing lifts you up. Glory to God. Tell somebody, I'm getting lifted up right now. I'm getting moved on up, moved on up, moving on in right now. I don't know what you all have done. I don't know if it's this new platform. I don't know what's happened. All I know, all I know is it's good. Listen, this is, I gotta give you this verse and we close. Genesis 31:1. Now Jacob heard the words of Laban's sons. This is what they were saying about old Jacob, the deceiver. They said, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's. And from what was our father's, he has acquired all this wealth. How did Jacob go out there? And Laban was deceiving him and deceived him again and again. But every time, glory to God, every time they tried to deceive Jacob, guess what happened? The blessing kicked in. There's some people been trying to work on you. Don't worry about it. You got the blessing at work. Are you here? Say amen. Another, Joseph had the blessing. Threw into the pit and the brothers were going to kill him, but the blessing brought him out. Somebody say, yeah, but he was sold into slavery. But go on and read what happened next. The Bible said that he found favor with Potiphar, and Potiphar put him over all his house. What's happening? The blessing kicked in. Somebody said, yeah, but what about old Potiphar's wife who false accused him? Yeah, that's all right. They threw him in jail. But go on and read a little further. The Bible said, then the jailer favored him because the favor of the Lord was upon him. And the jailer put him over the whole jailhouse and never even checked on anything Joseph did because he saw the favor of the Lord working in his life. The blessing at work. Then what do you see next? Joseph is sitting in the palace, second in command over all of Egypt. Somebody said, well, it was a coincidence. No, it wasn't. It was the blessing at work. If the blessing worked for them, it has to work. Somebody said, wasn't you going to give us some New Testament? I'm glad you asked. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things shall be added unto you. That's a good God trying to get good things to you. Somebody said, well, that's one verse. Go to John 10:10. The Bible says the thief cometh not before to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. Not less than, more abundantly. And some versions, you go read it in several, but it all says the same things. Means you're going to have life at its best. Life at its fullest. You're going to have everything you need in this life. Somebody said, well, that's two verses. Yeah, but what about where Paul told the Corinthian church in their giving? He said, God will cause all grace to abound toward you, that you will have everything you need in all sufficiency, and that you will be made rich in every way so that you will be able to give on every occasion. God is working for our good. Now, y'all ready to go home, or do I need to preach some more? I heard a few. Everybody say, we're moving in. This word will set you free. See, here's the thing. You're going to walk in the blessing wherever you go if you're following God. We're going to have to come back and deal with that. But when you go to work, you go in the blessing. Amen. When I needed a job at Delta Airlines back in 95, I was not qualified to get a job there. I was a pastor, and they weren't hiring pastors. But I really wanted a job with Delta Airlines. I thought it'd be neat to have a job with the airlines. I didn't know anybody who would work for the airlines. I thought this would be neat. And so I went to work temporarily, got in the door, and every day that I walked across the big Delta Airlines parking lot, which was huge, by the way, when I got out of the car, the whole time I walked toward that big building, and there was the big Delta symbol on the side of that building, I would say, Lord, I thank you that today I'm blessed to do this job better than anybody else here is doing it. Somebody said, well, that's kind of prideful. I'm not having any pride in myself. I'm believing the blessing is going to enable me to do it better than anybody else doing it today. I thank God for the blessing all the way across that parking lot into where I worked as a temp that nobody knew I existed. I was supposed to be there about 3 weeks. 2 months later, I'm still a temp. And a lady by the name of Pat Cole, who is known in that company, was known as one of the most demanding supervisors in that company, needed an assistant to come alongside of her and take care of some things. I had never met her in my life, but my name came up. Somebody said, why would your name come up? The blessing. Guess what? Pat Cole wasn't a Christian woman. She might be now. She cursed like a sailor. And here I am, a minister. She knows I'm a minister. Guess what? She hired me. I worked with her until the day I went back into ministry full time and had a wonderful relationship with her and learned greatly from her because of the blessing. Now, somebody said, and the Lord told me to tell you this, that's just a coincidence. When you say it's just a coincidence, you have more faith in coincidences than you do in the God you serve. I have no faith in coincidences. Do coincidences happen? They may, and yes, they do occasionally. But my faith is not in a coincidence. My faith is in the blesser who gave the blessing upon me. And wherever I go and whatever I do, I'm depending on the blessing to produce the blessing. If you receive this morning, shout amen and stand to your feet. Hallelujah. You don't have a clue the blessing God is just releasing over us. Thank you, Lord. Lift your hands right now and just thank Him. Oh, there are blessings that have come upon you through the blessing you've not even considered yet. Hallelujah. There are things that were sent to take you out early and to destroy your life. And the devil couldn't do it. And it's all because of the blessing upon your life. Thank Him. I want to hear some sound. Open your mouth. Lord, we thank You for this blessing. Thank You that You brought us out. But thank You, Lord, You also brought us in. And Lord, we thank You that we're going further in to be more blessed in the days ahead. We're walking in it. We claim it. We're living by it. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Bow your heads right where you are. Amen. Now, as you say, how can I be a partaker of that blessing? Listen, the blessing comes upon you when you get saved. It's a sad day that in the church, there's no teaching on this. It's called in Scripture in the New Testament, your inheritance. Did you ever notice the early church walked greatly in this blessing? I mean, they walked in it. And they had signs, wonders, miracles, supernatural provision. I mean, the Lord just blessed. They understood this. But we've lost it over the years because of tradition. But you enter into blessing when you receive the Lord into your life. Don't receive Him just as an eternity difference maker. And I think it's sad that many through the church world, the only reason they accepted Christ was to miss hell. And God says, I want to restore and do so much more in your life than help you miss hell. Your life is going up as you know the Lord. Now somebody said, Pastor, you're saying there's no trouble, no trials. I'm not saying that. The Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but my God delivers him out of them all. The difference is what you go through, the storms you face, you go through those with the blessing. The blessing kept Saul, whose name was Paul, changed to Paul, alive and everybody alive on that ship when it went down. The blessing enabled him to shake a snake off in the fire when everybody's looking and said he ought to die. He lived because of the blessing. I know I'm giving you a lot to think about. But right now, if you're here in this house and you've never received Christ into your life, you're receiving Christ not just to miss hell, you're receiving Christ to become a daily part of your life, to begin to move you into the blessing of the Lord fully, completely. Moving forward into the things of God. Is there anybody here today who would say, Pastor, pray for me. I need Jesus in my life. If that's you, would you slip your hand up right where you are? I need Jesus in my life. I've never been saved. I've never received Christ. And I need Jesus in my life. I need to receive Him. If that's you, would you slip your hand up right now? Anybody? Is there anyone today who said, Pastor, pray for me. I've been saved. But I really need to recommit my life to Christ. I want to get back in the flow of the blessing. Now listen, when you're out of fellowship with the Lord, blessing don't flow. Covenant don't flow. doesn't flow. And so if you're here today and you need to recommit your life to Christ, you need to start over, we want to give you that opportunity. Anybody here today, Pastor, pray for me. I need to start over fresh and new. I need to recommit my life to Jesus. I need to rededicate my life. Anybody?